I'm excited to be here today with Jared Diamond. Jared is a professor of geography at UCLA, and he is an author that has written a huge number of books, including and probably most famous for Guns, Germs, and Steel, for which he won a Pulitzer Prize. Today, we're going to talk about his most recent book, Upheaval, Turning Points for Nations in Crisis. It's really a pleasure to have you with us today, Jared. Thank you so much for making the time.
I'm delighted to be with you.
I actually just want to start with the premise for the book. And one thing that really struck me is that you said that you owe the idea of this newest book, Upheaval, in part to your wife, Marie Cohen, who's a psychologist. And she has some deep experience of individuals in crisis. And you thought there was a lot of relevance between that and thinking about nations in crisis. Can you talk to us a little bit more about how you came up with the idea for the book and why individuals are relevant to nations?
Sure. The background is that I've lived in half a dozen countries over the last 60 years, and each country that I live in, it either went through a crisis before I moved there or it was in a crisis. I was living in Germany on the day the war went up, or I started working there as it was coming out of a crisis. If you're one of those who believes that correlation proves causation, you may think that Jared Diamond living in a country causes a crisis, but no, it's just that countries often have crises. So I'm interested in national crises. And then as for personal crises, naturally I've had my own share of personal crises, professional crises, breakup of my first marriage. Marie, my wife, a clinical psychologist, when in the first year of our marriage, Marie was doing a specialty training in an area of psychotherapy called crisis therapy, which is not the usual spend a few years exploring your early childhood events. Instead, crisis therapy is to help people who have had a personal crisis like breakup of marriage, death of a loved one, getting fired, and they have to deal with the problem quickly because in the worst case, there's the risk that they'll commit suicide. So each week, Marie and her fellow therapists would go over the cases, try to figure out who was working through their problems and who not. They came up with a dozen outcome predictors. And as Marie told me about these outcome predictors for personal crises, I realized many of them map well onto national crises and others suggest serve as metaphors for national crises. So it was Marie's experience of helping people with personal crises that formed the framework for my book.
And while there's a lot of similarities, which you just laid out there, there's obviously some pretty obvious differences between individuals and nations in crisis. And one difference is clearly leaders and leadership. Nations have them and individuals don't. Can you talk to us a little bit about the role, as you see it, of leaders in crisis?
Sure. For an individual, When my first marriage broke up, it's not that I needed some leader to get me out of it. I had to deal with it myself. So for us as individuals, the role of leadership is irrelevant. But for nations, for groups in general, and certainly for nations, leaders are significant or may be significant. Often, leaders make the difference, for better or for worse. Churchill made the difference for the good for Britain in 1940. Hitler made a difference for the bad for Germany in the 1930s. There are, though, exceptional cases of countries where the leader doesn't make a difference because all the leaders are good and equally good. An example is Switzerland. In Switzerland, the prime minister changes every 6 months. And when I last went to Switzerland, my Swiss friends, they couldn't tell me who was the prime minister at that time because Swiss prime ministers, they're all good and they're interchangeable. There's a case where leadership doesn't make a difference, but usually leadership does make a difference for the better or for the worse.
You've said in the media that this is one of the first times that the whole world has been unified in facing a visible enemy. Can you just help us understand what you meant by that comment and what is the impact of that?
Right. When we think of, so COVID is a problem facing the world, but of course there are other problems facing the world, of which a prime example is climate change, overexploitation of limiting resources. But the fact is that the world has not gathered together to face the enemy of climate change. And yet the world may be gathering together to face the enemy of COVID. Why the difference? I think it's clear. COVID kills you within a couple of days. And if you die, there's no doubt that you died of COVID. Whereas climate change takes a long time to kill you, and it kills you more indirectly, for example, by air pollution or by flooding sea level. So COVID is a visible enemy that perhaps for the first time in world history, the whole world recognizes that every country, Bolivia, the United States, Mongolia, we all face the same enemy of COVID. It's a more dramatic enemy than climate change.
I want to pivot a little bit and talk about the U.S. And in Upheaval, you spend a chapter talking about the U.S. being in crisis. And you make the point that some crises are precipitated by a single event, a moment in history that is a catalyst for a lot of change. And other ones kind of build up over time. And when you think about the challenges the U.S. are facing, or the crisis, as you put it, you have said that it's something that has built up over time. Can you expand on that a little bit for us and identify for us what is the crisis you think the U.S. is facing at the moment?
Sure. The contrast case would be COVID, which hit us rather suddenly in January and February. And the other crisis case was the World Trade Towers attack, which in the course of a few hours precipitated the United States into crisis. But sad as COVID is not the biggest crisis facing the United States. COVID is going to get solved within the next year or two. There'll be vaccines. The bigger problems facing the United States are the slowly creeping ones. First and foremost, political polarization, which has gotten worse and worse in the last 20 years. The essence of a democracy is reaching a compromise. But in the United States, increasingly over the last two decades, the two parties have not compromised with each other. There has not been compromise within the Republican Party, nor within the Democratic Party. There's a breakdown of compromise between the executive and the legislature and the judiciary. I see that as the most acute problem for the United States, more acute than COVID, because it's the problem that threatens the end of American democracy. And of course, we have other creeping problems, such as our increasing inequality and restrictions on voter registration and decrease in government investment in public good.
The really interesting thing to me about that answer is that when we think about the U.S. being under threat, the narrative that's often told is that threat is exogenous, that it's coming from another country or a disease, for example, in the case of COVID. But you're actually making the argument that we're the greatest threat to ourselves and our democracy. Is that a fair reading of how you're thinking about it?
You are absolutely right. One of the commonest reasons for people to fail to resolve a crisis and for countries to fail to resolve the crisis is not to accept responsibility for what you can do yourself, but to blame it on somebody else. Here in the United States, there is much blame against Canada, and there's blame against Mexico for causing us problems. And most of all, there's blame against China for causing us problems. But the reality is that Canada and Mexico and China cannot do anything to undermine American democracy. The only people who can undermine American democracy are we Americans.
And I want to just, if I could go into a little bit more detail on some of those challenges that you identify the U.S. facing. So let's pick political polarization for a moment. In your book, you also talk about technology exacerbating that. And obviously, we're in a moment now where we're more dependent on technology than ever. If we weren't in the COVID-19 crisis, you and I would be in the same room together. So, I mean, we're in a way we're depending on it more than ever. Can you just unpack that argument, connecting political polarization to technology, and maybe a solution for how we could make some of that better?
Yeah. Why is it that political polarization has been increasing in the United States in the last 20 years? There is political polarization growing in other countries such as Britain and Australia and Korea, but it's worse in the United States. Why is it growing in the US at all? And why is it worse in the United States than other countries? This is just a ground for speculation. But my speculation is that it has to do with the breakdown in face-to-face communication. This is something that I'm very conscious of because I've been working in the jungles of New Guinea for the last 55 years. New Guineans, all communication is or was face-to-face. you talk with a New Guinean, there's no cell phone, there's no computer, there's no telephone. You are sitting 2 or 3 feet from the person and you're looking them in their eyes and you feel their body language and you smell them. It's a real person. If you got a real person in front of you, you have some inhibitions about being insulting to a real person. Whereas if your communication is words on a screen, it's easy to be insulting and disparaging to words on a screen. So my hunch is that the breakdown in civility, including political compromise, in the United States in the last couple of decades has been because of our decline in face-to-face communication, that we're experiencing people not as people, but as words on a screen. And it's why the polarization is worse in the United States than in other countries. It's that in this respect, as in so many other respects, the United States leads the world, both in good things and in bad things. We're the leaders in technology, including good technologies and bad technologies. And I see polarization increasing in other countries, but we came first.
I want to now talk a little bit about the situation in the U.S. and in the context of some other countries and historical examples that you write about in your book. For me and for some other people I've spoken to who have read this book, one of the most chilling chapters, if you will, is actually what you write about Chile, which was a very well-functioning democracy up until the military coup in 1973, and then it fell quite rapidly. And if you take the American example and are extremely pessimistic about it, that's one route that one could go. I wanted to get a sense from you. Do you think there are parallels there? And are you assigning a high probability to the threat to American democracy?
Of course there are parallels and of course there are differences. And yes, there is a significant threat. The parallels are that when I lived in Chile in 1967, Chilean democracy, Chileans had pride of themselves on their history of democracy. My Chilean friends explaining to the American visitor me what Chile was like, they said, "We are a democracy. We're not like those other Latin American countries. We know how to govern ourselves and our army does not step in." This was 1967. 1973, nevertheless, Chile had a coup d'etat that ushered in the most sadistic government in modern world history. Things deteriorated. The warning signs were there in Chile in 1967. They got worse. In the United States, the warning signs are here in the United States. The warning signs are especially that the essence of a democracy is that people can vote. But in our democracy, increasingly, citizens are being prevented from voting. It's being made difficult for them to register. We've already heard yesterday that there are 50,000 volunteers being sought to appear at the polls in November to inspect people coming to the polls and to deter them from voting and to see whether they're entitled to vote. So those are the restrictions on democracy in the United States. In Chile, democracy ended with a military coup d'etat. In the United States, democracy will not end in military coup d'etat because the American military has never been involved in politics. Instead, American democracy, if it ends, will end in the way that it is ending now, namely restrictions on voters being able to vote.
There's obviously, and I'm an equity investor, so I'm an optimist, so I need to end this discussion on America with some optimism too. There is a better way, and in one of your chapters where you talked about Japan, the Meiji Japan, and then you talked about modern Japan. In Meiji Japan, you made the comment that when the Americans approached, and I think it was 1853, it was a catalyst for Japan had to change, had to evolve. And one of the things that they did that was quite effective was travel more around the world, look to other countries as models that they could adopt and take some of the best parts of different countries around the world to go on their own path of modernization and evolution. Is there any parallel there between what Japan did and what maybe could be the solution for the US? As I know we have so many committed people to getting to the other side of this in better shape.
Of course there's a parallel. Japan in the 19th century, in the so-called Meiji era, faced a crisis in that Japan was not well armed and Japan began to be visited first by an American fleet and there were the British and French in the background threatening to carve up Japan as the British and French were in the process of carving up China. as far as the United States, but Japan responded. In the United States, it's not that it's too late for us to respond. There are lots of Americans who are very concerned about the situation in the United States. One of the hopeful signs is that young people in the United States are increasingly concerned. That's a hopeful sign. And another hopeful sign is that big businesses in the United States are very concerned. As an environmentalist, 20 years ago, if you had asked me, Jared, what do you think of big businesses? I would say big businesses are the most evil force in the modern world today. But I'm on the board of directors of World Wildlife Fund, and I was on the board of directors of Conservation International. And I've seen how big businesses operate. Many big businesses are, in fact, among the most positive forces in the world today, because many big businesses, such as Walmart and Unilever and even the big oil companies, have recognized that for the business to thrive, the country has to thrive, and the business's employees have to thrive. So I'm cautiously optimistic that although there are grounds for pessimism in the United States today, especially the motivation of young people and the efforts of big businesses, make me cautiously optimistic. I would rate our chances as at least 51% that we will get through our problems, and no more than 49% that we'll make a mess of it.
Okay, I'll take 51%. That sounds like the odds are in our favor. So we'll go with that. And I think those comments were really helpful around business being able to play an important role in improving many aspects of society. And at Goldman Sachs, we're obviously very focused on sustainable growth and thinking about how to help companies and also countries grow sustainably over the long term. And one of the things that we think could be a positive legacy of this crisis is more people focusing on environmental, social, and governance issues, and understanding that we have to care about those issues to put all of ourselves onto a sustainable growth trajectory. And with that, I want to pivot to the last section and talk a little bit about the global perspective. And you wrote a chapter on some of the major challenges facing the world and mentioned a few of them earlier. I actually do want to dig a little bit more into climate. You are an environmentalist. Can you just give us a sense of, when you started to get focused on this issue, how important you think it is, and your conviction level on our ability to come together to solve climate specifically?
Sure. Let's place climate in a context, though. There are other big problems that the world faces. Perhaps the four biggest problems that we face are the thing that can kill the most people in the shortest time is, of course, nuclear weapons. So there's the nuclear risk. There's the reality of climate change. There's the reality of overexploitation of essential resources, notably seafood and forests and topsoil and water. And then there's the problem of inequality around the world. As far as climate is concerned, COVID is a model for climate. No country in the world can escape COVID. Nobody is immune to COVID. COVID is a threat to every country in the world. If the United States succeeded in eliminating COVID within its boundaries, the United States would still be at risk because we are connected to other countries in the world. In other words, COVID is a global threat, but climate change is also a global threat. Even if the United States reduced carbon dioxide levels immediately in the atmosphere over the United States, the atmosphere is mixed. That's to say, climate change caused by greenhouse gases, notably carbon dioxide, climate change is a global threat. So another reason why I'm cautiously optimistic is that COVID really is catching our attention because it kills people within a couple of days. It looks as if the world is going to get together to deal with COVID and to recognize that as a global problem. But having done that, my hope is that we will then be motivated to deal with other global problems, notably climate change, which until now we've been lukewarm about because it just doesn't kill us fast enough.
And when you address those other global problems and you list all four of them, is it the one at this point that you're most optimistic that we can make the progress on climate?
If and hopefully we will, solve COVID with vaccine in the next year or two, my prediction is that it will then focus attention on climate change, because there's already a lot of discussion about climate change. There's more discussion about climate change than there is about depletion of the world's fisheries or loss of the world's topsoils. Already, say 7 years ago, the majority of Americans, poll showed, did not believe in climate change, and if they recognized its reality, they regarded it as due to natural causes. Now, within the last half dozen years, the majority, something like 70% of Americans, or then though maybe 40% of our Congress people, 70% of Americans believe in the reality of climate change and believe that it's caused, recognize that it's caused by humans. So my prediction is that once we solve COVID in the next year or two, the next thing for which will be possible to pull together world support for global action on a global problem will be climate change. And after we've dealt with, while we're dealing with climate change, then it may be possible also to muster together world support for dealing with inequality and the nuclear issue and resources in limiting quantities.
I just want to end by encouraging everybody watching to read Upheaval. It's a really tremendous book, and kind of ending where we started and connecting the individual to the nation. There is a very optimistic message here that deliverance I think is possible if we don't fall subject to denial. We have the humility to recognize as either individuals or a nation when we're facing challenge, and the confidence to look outside for answers. I think that for me was a great lesson from this book, and I hope everybody else enjoys it as much as I do. Thank you so much for your time, Jared. It's really been a lot of fun to talk to you today.
Thank you, Katie, for your time. You've done more work preparing for this interview than I did, so I thank you.